What we are hearing now is something about Gradle. Does everybody know Maven? Okay. Anybody who doesn't know Maven? Perfect. So everybody. Fantastic. Okay. With the exception of you. It's typical for me to talk too long, so if you need to get a coffee, you should do it now. Gradle is a, one could say, replacement for Maven. The question is why. Maven is the first build management system that has introduced something like a life cycle into the idea of building your software. It was brilliant at the time. I mean, if you look at the history, we had shell scripts, something like that first. Then came Make. Anybody still knows Make, the Unix tool? Okay, one guy at least. Okay, fantastic. That was prevalent for, it felt like 200 years or something, even when in fact it was only, say, 20 years or something. Starting in the 70s and going until the 90s. In the 90s, with the rise of Java, everyone knows Java, I think, came the idea to have something else that can be used to build your software. Before that, on every system you had Make as a tool. Every Unix system, even Microsoft Windows had a Make implementation that could read Make files. And with the advent of Java, everyone said, okay, we want to have something that is system independent and whatever written in Java, because if we are building software for Java, then we need a virtual machine anyways, so we can use that language to implement something different, something more elegant, something absolutely brilliant. And nearly everybody tried to invent a new replacement for Make, even me. And the general public working with Java chose the worst possible thing, namely AND. I still don't understand it. AND is, for me, really awful. But nonetheless, many used it, many liked it. And AND had the single problem that you don't have anything like a life cycle built into it. You need to explicitly express your build process in AND. And Maven was the first tool that absolutely brilliantly at the time forced the users to a life cycle, forced them to, for instance, forced them to use a directory structure that was dictated by the build system. Totally crazy, but nonetheless, it was the first step for everyone to being able to get into a new project and without knowing anything beforehand, being able to find everything they needed. Because every project that uses Maven has the same directory structures. So everyone can work with the Maven project. The problem with Maven, on the other hand, is that these definitions are totally strict. You can't change them. Try to change the source directory structure for a Maven project, and it drives you crazy. So, on the one hand, it was absolutely brilliant because you got these predefined things. On the other hand, in the industry, you have a situation where not every time you can use these structures, but you have to adapt to the situation at a customer site in some way or the other. And exactly there you get into problems with Maven. The important thing, on the other hand, is as long as you don't get into problems and have an existing Maven build, stay with it. Don't change anything only because you want to play with anything new. I mean, we are talking about build systems. If I talk about development, about a new project, about new frameworks, then I have a different viewpoint, because then it's quite interesting to play around, to fool around with new things. I mean, I love Groovy, for instance. For Java programmers, that's something new. Nonetheless, I would absolutely vote for you to use and play around with Groovy. But that's the development view. If we are talking about build systems, then we have to adopt a different view. We have to adopt the view of the build manager, who wants nothing but stability. And if we are in this position of the build manager to change the central tool that builds our system, is at least a crazy idea. So there has to be quite a number of problems with our existing build to force us to change it. So as long as you don't have really hard problems or big problems with Maven, stay with it. If you are starting a new project, that's something different. Then you can think about Gradle. And Gradle is, yep, quite simple in comparison to Maven, and quite adaptable in comparison to Maven. We will see a little bit about it. Since you all know Maven, I can, I think, skip over the first few points regarding what we need and what we want in a build management, maybe what we want. Then we go directly to the basics of Gradle. I even did some example projects to let you see that it really works, as I say. And a minimal or minimum Gradle project file contains exactly one line, so that it's quite short in comparison to something like Maven or even Ant. The one thing that I don't really talk about is migration. If you want to migrate from an existing project to Gradle, with Maven it's a little bit work. With Ant it's absolutely no work, because Ant tasks or Ant targets are first-class citizens in the Gradle world, which means you simply read an existing Ant file and can use everything in it. Which means, in turn, you can migrate step by step, minimizing any risk that you have in migrating your build as a whole. And again, let me emphasize this. If you are in the role of a build manager, if you are the one who is responsible for the build system, never change anything until you absolutely must. Stay stable, regardless of what the developers say. Okay. Yeah, and then we'll do a few projects. Okay, what do we have here? This is the needs. I mean, Maven, even Make provide this functionality, so I won't go into detail here. What we would like to have is something that Maven doesn't provide, an explicit view on the workflow we have, on this life cycle, on what happens, and the ability to change this. Changing the different phases in Maven is a very complex thing to do, and you won't ever touch it. In Gradle, it's quite normal to do this, to adapt even this life cycle to your needs. But per default, if you simply start Gradle without any changes, it provides you with the same functionality, with the same life cycle, even with the same conventions that Maven does. So you can switch from Maven to Gradle quite fast, as long as you don't use any complex plugins that in Maven most often are used to get around some of the limitations that the tool has. Okay, what else do we have? Simple modifiability, reading a Maven script for someone, a POM, for someone who has never seen it. yeah. You won't like it for the first time. Okay. The rest doesn't matter. The basics. Gradle uses a script that is called build.gradle. Gradle implements a full Groovy compiler, which means that it provides the full Groovy language in your build script. So every Gradle build script is a Groovy script. So the full language functionality is there for you to use, for you to express whatever you want. It's a different discussion whether you should use it, whether you should use it in the normal build file, but nonetheless, if you need some arcane functionality, some black magic that no plugin or whatever else provides, you simply write it yourself in Groovy, one of the most expressive languages that at least I know. Okay, the principles, the design principles are: don't repeat yourself. Do everything you want only once, and this is followed to quite some extent even in the code. So sooner or later you will look into the source code of Gradle itself simply out of curiosity how they do something, and you will see that it's in parts brilliantly coded, and most of this code is provided to you to use yourself in your own coding as far as you need it. And the second thing is convention over configuration, which means that as long as you want to stay in the Maven convention world, you have to do nothing. But on the other hand, if you want to change something, you can change it. You can change everything. And this is the important difference to Maven, or the philosophical difference to Maven, where in Maven, everything is fixed. In Gradle, everything is open. You can change it, you don't have to. But if you need it, it's there to be changed. Okay, Gradle creates a dynamic representation in form of a directed acyclic graph. This simply means some nodes, some arrows that connect the nodes, and no cycles. This DAG is simply computer science speak for nodes and arrows. And down there, I have a simple directed acyclic graph that depicts, very much simplified, the dependency between different nodes that in turn represent single steps in a build process. We have a compile step. We have an assemble step that puts all of our sources together, puts in a jar every class. A second step that compiles test classes. A third step that tests. And a last that does the final build stuff. And if I want to execute the build step back there, then I first need to execute the test step and the assemble step. To do that, in turn, I have to execute compile test, and to do that I have to compile the whole stuff. Now this representation allows Gradle to extremely fast find out what has to be done to execute one step in our process. In Gradle, these steps are called tasks, and you can call every task that, or execute every task that exists simply by providing it as an argument on the command line. And then Gradle builds this graph and decides which other tasks, which other steps have to be done before this task is done. And I can simply change these arrows, these dependencies between the tasks during the first phase of the execution of the build, so that I can add whatever I want into this build process, introduce my own steps, introduce my own dependencies, preconditions, whatever, into a build. And this makes it very helpful if you have a complex environment in which you have to build your stuff. Okay. If we are talking about Gradle, then we have to talk about two phases. We have a configuration phase. That's the first step. When we execute Gradle, if we start Gradle, then the first step is a configuration phase. In this configuration phase, the Gradle build file is read. Every command in it is executed, and the objects and object networks that are needed for a later execution phase are changed, adapted, new objects are added, and so on. And this differentiation allows us to first set up the stage, create everything that we need, and in a second step, the execution phase, simply execute every of the actions that we need to execute to do our build. So this configuration phase comes first, and only after it is complete, we start the execution phase. Which means that in the first phase, these dependencies are built, this DAG is built, and in the second phase, every action that is, or every task that contains actions that is in this DAG and needed for the execution is then in the second step executed. And this differentiation is very important because only if you know this, you are able to understand what happens in detail. Okay, the first simple script for Gradle is this here. Who knows Groovy? Anybody who was in my talk yesterday? Didn't get bored? Okay, one. This here is a normal Groovy command. And this is also a valid Gradle script. This does nothing but print this text, and that's it. But it's okay, if you don't want to do anything with Gradle anyway, to do this. So this is the first step you do. You do something in the configuration phase. In the execution phase, as I told you, the DAG or the tasks in the DAG that has been built before will be executed. Okay, I have to, one moment, look what I had as examples. Okay. I have this build.gradle, and if I execute Gradle, I add a minus Q. Minus Q is simply be quiet. So the default information for instance, that I don't give a task to execute right now, will not be printed. And the result is, should be coming right now. There we are. Hello from the configuration phase. Pardon? Ah, yes, sorry. I wrote that on the slide, I might not have said it. Build.gradle is the default name for the script, for the build script. I can provide another name and then I have to use the command line argument minus b. Then I can give an explicit name. But by default, it is simply build.gradle. Okay, so this worked. There we are. Okay, next phase, execution phase. As I said, the DAG is built in the configuration phase, and then at the beginning of the execution phase, Gradle starts looking at this graph and deciding and decides which of these tasks have to be executed. And if I simply say Gradle build, which is the typical way to call Gradle, then it decides, okay, it has to first compile, then compile, test, and assemble, and then test, and then build. And the operation to find this programmatically is, I think, O of N, which in any normal case is a joke. Gets more or less instantaneously. Okay. Now the next step is to create tasks. If we want to create our own DAG, we have to create tasks. And this is something that happens quite often in Gradle, because in these tasks you encapsulate programmatically what you want to do. I mean, later we will see there's a lot of default tasks. And in simpler cases, you don't need tasks of your own. But as soon as it gets a little bit more complicated, you need tasks. And this is quite simple. You start with this line here. This creates a new object of type task that can, after this line, be called as hello task. You can add to the list of actions that this task contains single actions at the beginning of the list or at the end of the list. And every action is nothing but a closure that encapsulates one step of this action. And the example I did here was with the command do last, append something to the list of actions of this task. With this left shift operator, do the same. This does the same as do last. And then there's a second method, do first, that append or that prepends, that inserts at the beginning one action. This results in this being the first action, then this the second action, and this the last action. Meaning, if I call the task hello task, I get hello from the execution phase. This is not how you normally do it. This is to show you the interaction of the different actions in your list. The next step is, how do I define the dependencies between different tasks? And this is quite simple as well. I have, when I create a new task, the opportunity to give some arguments. And in this case, I simply say, okay, this task depends on the task hello task. And this, in fact, adds one of these lines, a dependency. And this is all that you need. Alternatively, you can use a configuration closure simply as a closure directly after your task that can contain the same as a command then. So this here is exactly the same as that. Okay? Can show you that as well. There we are. If I know, Gradle has a lot of command line options and has the ability to question Gradle about tasks, about specifics of the build file you have. If I simply ask Gradle what tasks are available, then I don't know why it's so slow. Then you see here the task post hello. If I give the additional option minus all, then you see here, now I get the hello task as well. Because the hello task or the post hello depends on the hello task, Gradle thinks, okay, this one is the important task that will be called most often, and since I do not use the hello task anywhere else, it might not be as important, and thus Gradle doesn't show it if you ask it to list the normal tasks. But you see here the dependency already between hello task and on post hello. So Gradle shows you very, very detailed information about what you can do and what you can't do. And if I now execute Gradle with a hello task, then we get hello from the execution phase, which is exactly what we thought would happen. If I now execute the task post hello, and I can use a shortened and abbreviated form of the name, simply by using the first letters of the camel case notation, I see that the task hello task is executed first, because post hello depends on the hello task. I hope it worked, yes. And then the post hello itself is executed. So it's quite simple to express your dependencies and really straightforward. There's no big secret, nothing hidden there. It's quite simple. Okay, Groovy, short overview, do I need it? You have seen the closures already, curly braces. The semicolon is optional, so in the normal build script, you don't see any semicolons. You have G-strings, which are strings with embedded variables. You can reference a normal variable by dollar and then the variable name directly inside your string, instead of having to put it together using the plus sign as in normal Java. Everything is an object, just as it is in Java, and you have seen the println optimization already. There's a lot of other shortcuts, and in general, Groovy provides you with what you think should work. So if you type anything in Groovy and you think, this should work, but I don't know whether it really does, it will. It's quite as simple as that. Okay, what else do we have? Named parameters, closures, collection iterators, but I think I don't have enough time to play around with that. Maybe one thing, I can give you a short example, this here. I won't execute it, but it works. You see a method called named parameters that takes a map, really a normal Java map of params. And in the next step, I extract a parameter surname and a parameter first name from this map. And I can call this method simply with what I have in the next line, name parameter first name colon Joachim last name colon Baumann. And if I don't want to give one of the parameters, then I simply leave it out. This is a groovy way to do it, but we will see it quite often in Gradle, this way of calling different things. So this is why I wanted to point it out. Pardon? Okay, as I said, I will need the whole coffee break. Okay, you're still laughing. Okay, now this was the preliminary stuff. Now we get to the interesting part, creating our first project. And we do this by using a plugin. Plugins in Gradle are numerous, and they encapsulate some functionality that you don't want to have as source code in your Gradle build script. They can be provided as jars using a URL by pointing to them somewhere in the file system, or, and Gradle is very nice in this respect, by putting it into a directory called build.src that is the place for Gradle to look for your own plugins. So if you have a project structure in a directory build.src, then everything that's in there will be provided as functionality in the build script itself. Which kind of shows the philosophy behind Gradle. Providing you with every functionality to extend Gradle as simply as possible. To do as much as you want with it, with the least amount of complexity. Okay, plugins modify the DAG, they add objects, they add structures, they change existing objects, they change the network of objects interacting with another, and in general do whatever they want. The Java plugin is one of those plugins. It's, I think, one of the most used plugins, and it's also one of the most complex, because when I start the Gradle, when I start Gradle with a normal build script without a plugin, then I only have a very small DAG. When I load the Java plugin, then the project object is heavily modified, new abstractions are introduced, new concepts are introduced, and I think 15 or 17, something like that, additional tasks are introduced into the DAG. But to use the Java plugin is quite simple. You simply say apply plugin Java, and then call Gradle build. That's it. And if you look at this line, apply plugin colon Java, Groovy allows you to drop braces if you don't really know, need them for the compiler to understand the code syntactically. So in reality, here you can add those normal braces and then have apply called with a named parameter Java. So what in the first step looks like something like a DSL or something complex is in reality simply a call to a Java method, a Groovy method, sorry. Well, to be honest, under the hood, it is a Java method. Okay, the Java plugin and most of the other plugins, for instance, Scala plugin, Groovy plugin, and well, as I said, most of the other plugins built on top of the Java plugin, they have, or they take the same assumptions, the same conventions. And one convention is the structure of your project. If you have a project Hello World, then it is assumed that directly beneath this directory you have the build.gradle, then a source directory, main and test, Java, Java, resources, resources. And if you ever have worked with Maven, then you know this is exactly the same structure. Meaning you have a minimum of work to do to change your existing project to Java. And then underneath it you find your normal Java classes. If, for instance, you want to use Groovy, then you use the Groovy plugin and have a directory underneath that is called Groovy, and here as well. You can, for instance, use Groovy for test and normal Java for your main classes. If you want to use Scala, then you use the Scala plugin and have an additional directory that is called Scala. So mechanism is always the same. And since it's only a convention, if you need to change it, then you can. No problem there. Then the final thing for our example, this is a absolutely brilliant business functionality in the method generate greetings data that simply returns an array list, sorry, with strings that have to be printed out later. I did this because later we want to test this stuff, and having only a main method that prints out Hello World, well, it's quite complicated to test that. In the main method, we do nothing but create a new Hello World object, then call the method and iterate to through the values that are returned. Okay. This class is placed under SRC main and so on. And I can show you what happens. So this is it. Build.gradle really contains one line. SRC main java.de gradle workshop hello java. And this is exactly the code that I showed you. I simply cut and paste it. And if I now say gradle build, then the class is compiled. I hope so. Yep. Any resources are processed. Well, I have no resources, so nothing to do there, which means Gradle, wait. There. Gradle prints out up to date. Then the classes are created. Everything here is a task of its own. So you see it, that the Java plugin introduces quite a number of additional tasks. But in the normal case, you need the build task or maybe the test task. And you see, since we don't yet have anything that tests our fantastic functionality, there's nothing to do there either. So the build is successful. And if now I start the build a second time, then Gradle prints out up to date for everything. At least I hope that it does. Yep. Because, and this is fantastic with Gradle, Gradle tries to find out what has been done already. It remembers what files you had. In fact, it builds a cache of MD5 sums, I think, and checks against these sums whether anything has changed, whether it has to do anything. I can show you exactly what that means. If I change, or let's do it simpler, if I change the date on my source code, but don't change anything else. Oops. then Gradle will recognize that it's still the same file and will do nothing. Meaning it is extremely fast in all those situations where you'd only change a little thing and then try to rebuild your whole application. So this is incremental build at its finest. And it even checks for dependencies that are not directly recognizable in the source files. We will see one of them in a moment. What I forgot. Now we have a directory build, and if you look at into the build directory, okay, we see different directories that have been created by Gradle. Everything that Gradle does for this project is put into the build directory. Private things like the cached checksums are in the .gradle directory, but the important thing for us is the directory build. And in the build directory, we have the classes directory where every class is. We have the libs directory where our project jar, this is the finished application, is, and a temp directory where other things are done. And if now I say java minus cp build libs and then de gradle workshop, right? Hello world, I think. Yep. Showing that the application has been built as we thought it should be. But still, there's something that we can do better, and that is the manifest. We want, for instance, to execute the jar directly, and this is possible by adding to the manifest file the information about the main class of the application in the jar. And in Groovy, you simply do this by saying, okay, I want to do something with the jar, and in the jar, I want to do something with the manifest. And then simply set attributes here, main class in that case, with this value. And again, you can put the braces here and have a method call. So this then, and the thing in the lower line here is exactly the same. It's an alternate notation if you don't want all the curly braces. Now, thank you. Wait, I should most probably, I have it in the next, wait. For manifest build.gradle to here. So now I copied the build.gradle file from the next example, which contains exactly this line, into this directory. I changed nothing else, right? So every normal build system now would start to build everything again. Gradle recognizes that the source files haven't changed, that the output files, the classes, haven't changed, that only the Gradle file, the build script itself, has changed, and that it contains something that changes the contents of the jar, which means that it has only to start there to assemble the jar again with different information. And this is what I meant, that even information that only indirectly influences the build process as a whole is passed and is decided where to start again with the build. So, you see, everything above here is okay, doesn't have to be changed, only the creation of the jar itself has to be changed. And with this change, I now can execute java minus, minus jar, build, okay, ignore that, yep, and it works. And if you don't believe me and think that as just some black magic, I can, in the temp directory, show you under the jar directory itself the manifest. And there you see exactly what I did in the Gradle script. So, quite nice, in my opinion at least. Okay, next step. We want to do some tests as well, naturally. This is my brilliant test class that uses an object under test, creates this in the setup phase, and then checks the number of results in the list that is returned by the method generate greetings data. Okay. The problem here is that Gradle does not yet know that I use JUnit for testing and doesn't have any idea what JUnit is. So we have to tell Gradle about the dependencies that we now have introduced. It's the same with every other build tool as well. And we simply use it by using the keyword dependencies. And this keyword changes something that is called configurations. And every major task in Gradle has normally such a configuration. And this configuration encapsulates source sets, meaning every source file that that is needed, every output, the dependencies, a lot of other stuff. So this is one of the central concepts, configurations and dependencies. And you simply manipulate them with this keyword and then say for which configuration you want to change your dependencies, in this case, test compile, and then simply use a Maven notation to inform Gradle what you need. Instead of this long version, you can also simply write JUnit:4.plus, the shortened Maven notation. Works the same. I like this one better nonetheless. This plus sign here means simply choose the newest version of this library. While this is very nice for us as a developer, for us as build managers, this is extremely bad because this introduces some risk that we cannot minimize. The problem is there might be a new version of this library that everyone thinks is compatible with our old version, but simply doesn't work with our application. And finding this might be quite complicated. So while as a developer we like this plus, as a build manager, we don't want things like this in our build files. So if you create your own build.gradle or your own Gradle build scripts, as long as you experiment until you finish, you should use this plus for simplicity. But before you give your build script to somebody else to use, remove any such reference and exchange it or change it to a exactly specified version. This is quite important for build managers. Okay, now we have the information what kinds of dependencies we have. The next step is that we need to inform Gradle about the repositories used to load this dependencies. And this can be your local Maven cache. This can be your local Artifactory installation or Nexus installation or whatever you are using as a cache for your artifacts. It can be JCenter as well. Yeah, and Maven Central And this is for Gradle, it's the same. It can use it without problems. And now we are able to download the respective jar and then in the next step build the whole thing. So still the same. I have the same main class. Now I have added the test class under the test directory tree and have added a repository, my own local repository, and dependency to JUnit. And if now I say Gradle build, Gradle is quite happy, starts to build it, I hope. Executes the tests and then builds the whole thing, which means that the tests are successful. And we can look at the result of the tests in build/test results and there should be an HTML file. Okay. Oh, no. Starts Xcode. Nope. We don't want that right now. Doesn't matter. This is the XML representation of the results. Wait. Here you are. Everything fine. Okay. And this XML version can then, for instance, be used by Jenkins to create an overview over everything. Okay. Then we have something called the application plugin that's more or less the same as the Java plugin, but it additionally creates startup scripts, shell scripts, and batch scripts for Windows to automatically start the Java application. And for this, you simply need a main class name to let the system know which class should be called. Quite nice for some applications. And then TestNG. I mean, we have used JUnit. This is the default, but you can use TestNG without problems. And you can even use both JUnit tests and TestNG simply by using or configuring the test to use TestNG and then add TestNG as a dependency. Then you use a TestNG class and everything works like before. And if you use both JUnit tests and TestNG tests, then it even combines the information about the tests in one file to let you review the report of the system without problems. But since coffee break is already on, I won't show you. Quality assurance is the next step. This can be done with PMD, with check style. You can even add sonar into the whole system, which is, in my eyes, absolutely brilliant. And it looks quite similar to what I have here. Apply plugin PMD. I get another plugin that adds the needed functionality for PMD, and then simply configure PMD. And here is another example that's a little bit more complicated, but still, I think you can read it. All tasks that have the type PMD, meaning PMD main and PMD test in that case, get the same rule tests. We ignore failures, meaning that the execution of the build is continued even if PMD sees something that it decides is a failure, we define specific rule sets and then define that the reports should be in HTML instead of XML. So this is quite readable. Even if you have never seen it before, you can say what happens. Try the same with Maven. Okay. And then the final step, when you have built your fantastic application with your brilliant business functionality, then say upload archives. This is one task that is generated automatically by Gradle. Define which repositories to put, you put your artifact in, and that's it. If there, in this definition, you have nothing, then it's placed in your local Maven repository cache under user home /.m2. So quite short in the definition. And this is everything you have to do to publish your stuff. It's brilliant. And this is the whole script. In this script, you use the Java plugin, you use the PMD plugin, you define the main class for your fantastic application. Define your quality rules. You say which repository to use to download the frameworks you are using. Say which frameworks you are in fact needing, and then define everything for your publishing. So this is a typical, fully fledged, full blown Gradle build script. In most cases, it doesn't get any more complicated than this. I have the example as well, but I hope you believe me that it works without showing. So, we have seen a full build management cycle with Gradle, seen everything that you need to create your application, to test it, to do quality assurance, to publish it, to use it in every normal situation. And you have seen it's 20, 25 lines, which means you know everything you need to know to use Gradle. You don't need more to start using Gradle in your own project. Surely it gets much more complicated if you want to migrate from a complex multi-project Maven build to Gradle, or if you have a 500-line AND script that you want to convert to Gradle. But for normal project, that's it. This is everything you need to know, which I find fantastic. So Gradle is simple, easily understood, extensible to a fault. You can do everything with it. I mean, you could, in theory, even write swing applications that are executed as soon as you start Gradle, but you won't do that, I think. And this means Gradle adapts to your every need, however you want to use it. And that's it. Thank you very much.